This is the September 7th Development Review Board meeting. We have a number of items on our agenda today. Two design review applications, a few conditional use permit applications, and some subdivision applications. And now is the time that we solicit public comment. If there's anybody, before we get started, I want to make sure that everybody signs in if they haven't yet. And then if anyone has any public comments they would like to share, now is the time to do so. Seeing no one coming forward, I'll assume there's no one here for that purpose, and we'll move on to the next item on our agenda, which is approval of the minutes of our last meeting on August 17th, 2016. Can I have a motion for approval?
So moved.
Does anyone have anything to add, or sorry, Alex, add or change to the minutes other than the spelling of Ms. Christensen's last name? Hearing nothing, I'll take a motion for approval.
So moved.
Can I have a second, please?
Second.
Mm-hmm. Motion is seconded. And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Hearing none. Motion carries. So this would bring us to item number 4 on our agenda, which is the two design review applications. The first one is for 104 Shelburne Wood Drive for a new 18 by 24 foot garage. The application is by Mr. Donald Phelps. Is there somebody here on behalf of the application? Mr. Phelps, if you would stand, take the microphone, tell us your name, and I will then swear you in, sir. And you may sit, too. You don't have to stand the whole time if that's more comfortable. Yeah, you don't have to.
My name is Donald Phelps. I live at 104 Shelburne Wood Drive.
Could you raise your right hand, please, sir? Do you swear or affirm to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Would you like to tell us about your application?
Okay, when Mr. Pete sold a park to the co-op, that's the Shelburne Wood Park?
Yep.
The property lines were changed.
Yep.
The new lines went right through the middle of the old garage.
Right.
The old garage had to be removed or moved. The bank would not close until the garage was either moved or removed. Mr. Pomelo had the garage removed. And I was the middleman on that. I did paperwork. The old garage was a 24 by 30 two-story. Now we would like to build an 18 by 24 one-story garage in the location the old garage was going to be relocated to.
Thank you. Do you have more to add to that?
No.
Okay. Does anyone on the board have any questions of the applicant? I do. Just so that I understand the map, sir, there's a square that says G. I assume that's the new garage, where the new garage is going
to
go.
Be located.
And the other garage is now gone?
The other one's gone.
Okay. Thank you. Does anybody else have any questions? Then I would make a motion to grant design review approval to Mr. Phelps for his 18 by 24 foot garage at 104 Shelburne Wood Drive per the drawings attached and received on August 23rd, 2016. May I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? None. Motion carries. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Have a good evening.
Thank you.
Good night. The next is from Mr. William Posey for 43 Fisher Place. It's lot number 2. It's a new single family home. Is Mr. Posey here? Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Can you state your name and raise your right hand?
William Posey.
Do you swear or affirm to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth, sir?
I do.
Okay, thank you. Would you like to tell us a little bit about your application, please?
Yes, this is an application for a 1,400 square foot single car garage located on lot 2 in the subdivision, which is right across the street from the post office. The house is a single story house. It's a two bedroom, has a one car garage, and it's built in the manner that the other house is in there. This, I think, is number four. I've been before you four. And I find a single family. The population is a lot older, and that seems to be what's in demand right now for the older people. I've gone through design review, and they've taken a look at the drawings, and I think the only thing that's different on that drawing that you might be looking at is it's a six-window front door rather than a four-window front door.
Anyone have any questions of Mr. Posey?
I do.
Just so I'm clear, lot six is the lot that got a nice house built on it
first. Yep, that my mother lives there.
And then which other houses have you built? I was only familiar with lot six.
Lot six has been built on. Lot three has a duplex on it. Lot five has a single family larger than this one. It's a story and a half style house. Mm-hmm. And it's a three bedroom. That's under construction and probably be done in about a month. And then this is lot number two.
Thank you very much. I must have missed a meeting or two.
I zip in and out quite a bit.
Thank you.
I'd make a motion to approve this design review application.
And I will second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? None. Motion carries. Thank you, Mr. Posey.
Thank you.
What did I do with the... There we go. Okay. We're already up to item number five on our agenda, and it's the application CU 16-06, application by Maurice Dubois for conditional use approval to convert a single family home to a duplex. The property is located on Route 116, specifically 5119 Route 116, and it's located in the rural district. Is there anybody here to testify on behalf of the application? Yes, ma'am, you have the mic already. Could you state your name for the record?
Shelley Dubois.
And Shelley, do you swear or affirm to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Okay. Could you tell us about your application, please?
Yep. It's an old farmhouse that we purchased probably around 2000, and we would like to have two apartments rather than just one big farmhouse. None of the outside will change. It will still look the same.
And does anyone have any questions?
Yes, Mr. McRae.
So the two apartments would they
one,
fall? One in the basement?
One is the whole top.
Okay.
And one would be in the basement.
Okay.
Originally, when this farmhouse was built, that's what it was. It was an apartment in the bottom and a house on top.
Okay.
But over the years, they let that go. And so because they let it go, it's not in your records. It's old. I don't know when it was built, the house. He was born there, so... It's older than him, so it's probably over 100 years old.
You need to tell us who he is for our record.
Oh, Mo Dubois.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Alex.
Ma'am, is there any outside access to the basement?
Yes, has its own door.
Okay.
It's a door, not a bulkhead?
No. Do you have?
I think it's in a photo.
This is the door.
Yep.
So it's really a split level.
Okay.
Yeah. So this is the main house, and this is where...
Yeah, so that's like a really private entrance.
It is.
Yeah.
Totally private.
Yeah.
Are there any other questions of the applicant? Anybody in the audience have questions for the applicant? Okay. That being the case, I would move to finalize the record for conditional use application CU 1606. May I have a second to the motion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? None. Motion carries. Then I'll next move to close the hearing with an indication of approval. We'll remind the applicant that a zoning permit is required prior to any improvements being made. And also a certificate of occupancy will be required as well. All in favor of the motion?
I'll second the motion.
All All in favor?
Well, it's been seconded, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, I don't think so.
No, this motion.
Well, I'll be glad to second that.
All right, thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? None? Application, the motion carries and the application's approved. Thank you very much for coming this evening.
Thank you. So I'll call you, Kate, so if I'm approved.
Thank you. The next application on our agenda is a subdivision application. It's actually a preliminary. We had sketch a few weeks ago for approval to resubdivide an existing 113-acre lot into two lots. The land involved is currently used for agricultural purposes. No further development is proposed. The property is located at 75 Harbor Road in the Conservation District and the Floodplain and Water Course Overlay Districts. Is there anyone present this evening to testify about this preliminary plan?
I am.
Can you state your name, sir?
Frank Talbott.
And do you swear affirm to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Can you fill us in again? I do have a couple of questions at some point, but if you would just give us a brief overview of what's going on to remind us.
Okay, so this is New Village Farm. It's up across from Shelburne Farms, 113 acres. About 5 years ago, we allowed Jeff Crow and his daughter to move on to 14 approximate acres and establish one mitten farm. And they built a barn and a riding stable and some other improvements. And now we're just looking to subdivide off that 14.6 acres and convey it to them. So there's no new change in really anything from what you see today.
So it's going from a license for use to sale, basically.
Exactly.
Okay. Do any of the members of the board have questions of the applicant? I do. So I broke a record. I think that there was a note in the materials we were given that you're proposing an additional access and making another curb cut.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about that?
The original access years ago went from the far east side of the property, which would be the line between New Village Farm and the Olson's property,
right,
which is between 3 and 2.
Yep.
And that was an access granted to for Peter Stern's lot, and I don't remember what lot number his was.
Two.
Oh, that's right. Over the years, they changed the access to right in the middle of lot 3. So if you drive by now, you'll see that Mr. Crow has a gate that goes right into his barn.
Mm-hmm.
So the original access rights allowed Peter to plant trees and hedges along his access route. So if we kept the access where it was, then it would, and Peter would have to give up something, his right to plant trees and such, and all traffic would go right through the parking lot of Jeff's barn.
Mm-hmm.
So the plan we decided to come up with was to just create another access on the edge of the property for Peter, leave Jeff's access where it is, and then create another access for New Village Farm, which is retaining the rest of lot 3.
And are those accesses depicted on the map we have? That's, oh,
they are depicted on the map.
They're not.
Detail.
Not in detail.
Well, there's a...
Right. Is that what you're looking at?
There's this little blowout, but...
Yeah.
There is a separate process for these curb cuts as well, and I understand that Mr. Crow has already spoken with the powers involved in who have jurisdiction over that, and they've already suggested that they don't have a problem with it.
Well, if I'm right, Mr. Crow will have to come. If we approve this, we're approving it with these proposed curb cuts, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. And they're in the blowout. I can see them, Frank, in the blowout on your map. And so there's going to be it just seems to me that's a lot of entrances on Bay Road in a pretty short distance.
Well, one thing you might want to keep in mind, though, is that the access to 3 is used in the morning when my wife goes up there to milk in the summer times, and other than that, it's rarely used.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. I don't even know how you'd get a vehicle up in there.
Well, she drives, she puts the cows up in that quarry area where it's shady during the summer, and she establishes a little milking station up there.
So she's the only one who's ever going to use it.
Well, she also runs educational camps, and sometimes the kids go up there in the summertime, but usually they drive up from the lower part.
Right.
We have had a situation once where the community school came over on a field trip, and a bus pulled in and dropped off a few kids from the community school up there.
So is there already a curb cut there?
Well, there's a road, but there's no curb cut. So then the access to Peter Stern's property right now isn't even used because the property is not developed, and if it is developed, it's just going to be a single family home.
Yep. Okay. Any other questions?
So that's not really adding anything. That's already there.
What's not adding anything?
This road that we're talking about is already there, right?
No, it is adding curb cuts. There's one there now.
Okay.
So it's a little confusing, so I don't follow up. So there's one curb cut there now, and that's the one that's used by One Mitten Farm, because
correct.
Peter Stern doesn't have a curb cut yet.
Right. And nor does Michaela, nor does New Village Farm.
Right.
Because the one curb cut goes right into the middle of their parking lot for their garage.
So
if she wanted to use it, we'd have to have an easement through his property, plus he doesn't really want that.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I don't blame him.
So what does she use now when she goes up there to milk?
Mm.
She uses his.
Okay, got it. Understood. All right. Any other questions? Can I have a motion with respect to this application? Does anyone wish to make a motion?
Sure. I would be glad to make a motion to finalize the record for preliminary plan application, SUB 9902R2.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Want to continue, Mark?
I would also then move to let the applicant for SUB 9902R2 be authorized to prepare a final plan application.
I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
And finally, I would move to close the hearing for preliminary plan application SUB 9902R2 and direct staff to prepare a decision indicating preliminary plan approval.
I'll second. Judy is second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? None. Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I think you have to recuse yourself from
this. Oh, yes.
I will.
The next item on our agenda is application CU13-18RI. It's a conditional use permit application by Civil Engineering Associates on behalf of Jeff Halvorsen for the purpose of the construction of a lakeshore erosion control structure, or structures. The property is located at 422 Lands End Lane in the Rural District and Lakeshore Overlay and Floodplain and Watercourse Overlay Districts. Anyone here on behalf of the applicant? You state your name and...
I'm Chris Gallipo with Civil Engineering Associates.
Do you swear or affirm to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Can you please give us an overview of the application?
So I think a couple of the board members are probably present back in 2013. We had put together a prior permit for the Halvorsen property, which is located on Shelburne Point, for a shoreline stabilization and access down to the shoreline. Since 2013, there's been additional erosion that has occurred in the sections that were not stabilized. During the original approval in 2013, as part of the original Shelburne Point subdivision, they had to establish the view management zones and the forest management zones, which I think you guys are familiar with, out at the point from the other parcels. The proposed project that we're proposing now is unique in the sense that there's no tree cutting at all. So the sole purpose of this project is to go in and basically provide the larger quarry stone, which would be consistent with what was already installed on Jeff's property and actually several properties along the point also, to basically hold up the existing embankment. There's a fair amount of erosion that's occurring out there. It's undercutting the embankment. As it undercuts the trees are just slowly falling in the lake, and the owner is losing vegetation. So with this project here, the view management, forest management zones have already been established. There's no additional tree cutting, and what we're doing is we're going in, or what we're proposing to do is to go in and basically key in these large quarry stones, which is taking an excavator with a hammer and basically creating a low spot so the quarry stone bites in, and then stacking the quarry stone up to stabilize the existing embankment. The owner's been interested in doing this for a little bit of time now, but it's actually the lake level's been so high that it's actually fairly unsafe to get out there. You can't go on top of the embankment because it's undermined. Mm-hmm. And when you're underneath it, there's a couple, 12, 15 inch trees that are actually, our hope is by doing this, we can save them. Probably 50% of the root structure is already undermined, and they're being kind of just supported by, the root structure that's going back into the embankment. Mm-hmm. So the hope is to save all that, key in. If you look at the plans, it basically constitutes an area between the existing walls where it was already constructed, a section on the northwest corner, kind of right at the point, and then there's a section directly due north of the Halvorsen residence that's under construction right now that's also severely undercut. It's a little cove area. Mm. So the lake level is actually low enough now where the project could occur, without a lot of, extra, barges or having to wait for it to freeze. So it's actually a good timing for the project. We have walked the site with Kate out there. Although we walked it with Kate, it was kind of unsafe and it was a little treacherous, but we did our best in the ice to get around. So that's kind of an overview. I don't know if you guys have questions. Yeah.
Can you point out the cove that you just referenced?
So the cove, so the Halvorsen residence is kind of, there's kind of, if you're looking at the property, there's kind of two points on the north side. This is the eastern side where the residence is, the drive coming in, and the existing cove is right here. Mm-hmm. That would be stabilized. These prior two coves were actually stabilized during the 2013 construction. And the construction actually, with the exception of one rock where the access is, it's actually held up great. The one rock rotated a little bit, which a contractor will come back and repair, but it's actually held up really good. I don't know if Kate distributed, but Mr. Halvorsen took a photo of the existing wall today and had emailed that over. I brought some photos for you guys. So I just brought a couple photos just to show.
Well, so between 2013 and now, the lake level was really high until now. So that would have, at the time that you started talking about this, that would have been a harder time to go after this kind of a problem because the lake level was high. This is the first year that the lake level has been reasonably low, or actually quite low.
Yeah, it's actually, the lake level right now is actually ideal, and if it continues to drop and goes into the winter and freezes, it's actually going to allow other properties that ordinarily have not been able to do anything potentially. Right. I mean, a lot of times it's cost prohibitive. If you always have the option of the barge and providing stabilization and shoring, but it's cost prohibitive. So with this, with the lake level being so low, it's actually kind of a golden opportunity. And there's other properties we're working with that are actually able to do maintenance on old, historic walls right now because mm-hmm. the water's so low. So it's actually a good opportunity.
Not unlike what Shelburne Farms had to do to restore the area in the lower garden.
Yes. Well, and they've also had some masonry walls they've had to restore. And actually, yeah. One of those projects is kind of ongoing now because right. the lake level's so low.
With this photo, Mr. Gallipo, what is the purpose of it?
I think the purpose was from the owner was just to show, in their opinion, how nice those walls blend in and how it's able to stabilize and actually blends in with the natural vegetation. It doesn't show like, it just jumps out at you with some concrete or masonry mm-hmm. wall that just doesn't look natural. It actually, when they first put them in, the rocks get scratched up a little bit and you can see that. But over time, as it wears and it ages a little bit, it blends in fairly decent.
Do I understand correctly that all of the sort of light, dark gray area that's got, on our copy, it has a, what would you call that, a serrated line?
Yeah, the hatching, that's the 2013, correct.
So basically, what you're doing is finishing.
Yeah, yeah, there still will be, I mean, if you look at how, you know, Jeff's property, there's still, I mean, I don't have the measurements, but I'm guessing 50% of the shoreline will still be natural, because everything in front of his house, with the exception of those three areas, will still remain natural. And that's actually a huge drop-off. I mean, it's, I don't know if it's 40, 50 feet. I mean, it's significant. I mean, there really isn't a lot of opportunity to do a lot there.
So another way he can get to the beach is going down that other road and walking down there, is that?
That is correct, yep. Yep, and that was the same access that the contractor used to last go around, and that's what's proposed now. We had actually looked at different options with this, because when we first started looking at this last winter, which is when we had Kate out there, the water level was high enough that there was really no way of getting out there unless the lake froze, and froze solid enough to carry an excavator. And in the tip of Shelburne Point, that doesn't occur very often. And so we actually looked at getting a barge in there and what the feasibility with that. But now we kind of have this opportunity with the water level being low that we can capitalize on that.
Thank you. Are there any other questions of the board members? Anybody in the audience wish to provide any testimony? Hearing nothing, I'll move to finalize the record for application CU08. What did I forget?
Nothing, I just wanted to point out one thing in the comments.
Yeah.
Is that
the review letter?
No, erosion control structures are supposed, they need to be built within the 98 and 102.
Yep.
It appeared that portions of it were outside of that. Now, I know that I think actually the wall that was built in 2013 didn't abide by that. I don't know if that was an administrative error or maybe it changed in between them. I don't think that happened. But I did want the board to consider it, that, you know, if there was a possibility of making some adjustments to actually have it conform to the bylaws, or if the board feels that this is the best solution.
Well, let me ask you, Chris, is there any way to, do you agree with Kate's assessment that you're beyond the 102-foot elevation contour?
All work is, we always key in above 98, and when you tie in on the corner so you have an in-cove situation, what we try to do is we try to fit the wall to the shoreline. Because what you run into is if we go out too far to 98 or 102, we actually have to bring in a lot more material to put behind the wall, right. And you're actually, some towns actually even refer to that as like land grabbing, where they'll say, okay, well, you're going out to 98, why aren't you starting the wall back at 105 or 104 or 102? So what we try to do is we try to balance that and see, okay, each shoreline's a little bit different, but why key in at 98 way out towards the water level and then have to bring in excess material when we can actually key in closer to where the erosion's occurring, right on the embankment, and basically run more of a, you know, we have to have a certain amount of batter. So as you set the rocks, you can't keep them vertically. We try to offset those. Mm-hmm. But as you do that, it really makes sense to key in as close to the natural grades as possible. So I actually, you know, in our office's opinion, by us pulling it back and actually keying in a little bit higher in elevation, we're doing a couple things. One, you're not gonna see as much reveal. So from an aesthetic standpoint, the wall actually appears smaller. We're not bringing in as much material behind it, so we actually feel that it's a better design. And like I said, this isn't, you know, staff brought this up, Kate brought this up, but we've, you know, permitted a lot of shorelines, and we've always done this. We try to fit the wall to the shoreline, and I'm not sure with the way the wording is, if that was the intention of the wording, or if it's the way you interpret it. And that's kind of, I mean, you guys can make the decision on that, but it's a little unclear as to how you do that. I guess from our standpoint, to go in at 98, when we could potentially pull the wall back to 103 or 104, from our standpoint, we think it makes sense to fit the wall to the shoreline and key it in at a potentially higher elevation. And then where you do the returns on either side, we have no choice but to do that. Does that make sense?
It makes sense.
Yes.
I like the fact that there's less reveal.
Yeah, and
that's in the end part.
Yeah.
I think that makes a lot of sense.
Agreed.
Everybody else agree? Happy? We're good.
Make you guys aware of it, so.
Yep, thank you.
All right. That being said, I would make a motion to finalize the record for this application, CU 8-02R2.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
All right. I then would make a motion to close with indication of approval for the same application, and including conditions 1 through 4, which are indicated in the staff report.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries. So we good?
Thank you.
Thanks, Chris.
And the next is a similar application. It's application CU 16-05. It's the application by Civil Engineering Associates on behalf of Shelburne Farms for a conditional use approval for a lakeshore erosion control structure. The property is located at 1611 Harbor Road in the rural district, lakeshore overlay and floodplain and watercourse overlay districts. Is there anyone in the audience on behalf of the application? Mr. Alapo, can you raise your right hand? Do you swear or affirm to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
You want to give us a little rundown?
Absolutely. So I'm not sure if everybody in the board is familiar with Shelburne Farms. I think you probably everybody knows Shelburne Farms. I'm not sure if you know where the Coach Barn area is.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So essentially, there's actually a little bit, if you look at the staff report, the ortho photo, the north area is actually pointing kind of in the wrong direction. So if you're looking, if you're at the Coach Barn and you're looking north, this would be on the left-hand side, so it would be the west side. Pretty much there's the Coach Barn and then you have the Coachman's house,
mm-hmm.
and it's actually just on the west side of the Coachman's house.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a road network that goes around the Coach Barn. The road network is used for the farm for different functions, events, and also for agricultural uses. And it also goes down further south to a residence that the farm owns. There's essentially a fair amount of erosion, actually a lot of erosion, at this location. It's a location that was actually permitted back in 2008 with John Adams. And back in 2008, it was a fill and excavation permit. We obtained a permit for a similar wall. But the farm at that point didn't have the funding to do that. As time moves on, there's been significantly more erosion, and actually we did the recent topographic survey. Trees that we had picked up in 2008 are actually no longer there, and there's other trees that are compromised. So the farm, given the water level and the access this year, and also the fact that they do have, you know, the availability to do this project this winter, they've asked that we move forward with the stabilization. The one change that we are proposing at Shelburne Farms in this wall is right now there's essentially a couple different coves. This is the road that comes kind of where I'm pointing south, but it comes along the Coachman's house is over here. This loops around the Coach Barn, this side down the Orchard Cove.
Oh,
there's
sorry,
a wall
sorry,
section
Jeff.
In here, which is the...
Oh, sorry.
Oh, sorry, Jeff.
Back.
We jumped. You familiar with the project?
Yeah.
Coach Barn?
Yeah.
The problem is the two applications are so similar. I guess I went right into the next one, sorry.
Try to get a jump on it. So essentially, there's a couple different coves. And then there's a point in between. So the cove on the south side is the larger of the two areas.
Mm-hmm.
And there's actually significant erosion. And I don't have all the exact dates. Marshall Webb from Shelburne Farms is here. They probably have the dates. But there has been, you know, riprap and larger quarry stone that's been dumped over the embankment over time. I mean, there's stones down there that don't match the natural vegetation. So I'm not sure on the timing of that, but it hasn't held up. And I think it's been more just dumped, and then you get the wave action that pulls the rocks out and they, you know, go on the lake. There is right now an existing wood set of stairs that goes down, and it's really not safe.
No.
So a couple of the options are is that we could go ahead and stabilize the shoreline and get a company to come in and put in, like, say, an aluminum set of stairs, which in our opinion, in the farm's opinion, doesn't fit the landscape. It's going to be shiny, you're going to see it, it's not going to be well-received in everybody's opinion. So the idea with this, and it's one that we've actually done on several projects, where you basically, if you look at the sections and also the profile, you'll see where we actually create a wall, and we break the wall and create an access ramp behind the wall. So it achieves access down to the beach, which is great for the farms, and it maintains what's already there. But at the same point, when you're at the lake level, you don't see that. So you don't see, you know, an aluminum set of stairs or a wood ramp or something that just doesn't fit in. And you also don't have the hassles of the farm having to take it in and out or having it on a, you know, a hinge system. So essentially what we're looking at is we're looking at this larger cove, and then just north of that, you go around the point, there's a couple small sections which would also be stabilized with no access going down. And then actually this ties into, right here, the existing masonry wall that loops all the way around to the inn. And that's actually a wall that they've had a lot of problems with appointing on it, and it's actually been crumbling. And so the farm right now is actually on a restoration project, just maintenance of actually repointing that wall, because the water level is so low, they're able to do that. So that's kind of an overview of the project. Again, it's a similar design to what the other walls have been. I don't know if you guys have questions.
I do. Yeah. On the southernmost cove, the one that has the falling down wooden stairs,
yes,
which have actually been trying to fall down for a while.
Yeah.
Why is access to that cove important? What I would almost think that given some of the instability in that area, that maybe it's a pretty place to stand and look at the lake, but why would it be important to put a ramp to even provide access?
It's always been used as access for the farm.
Yeah.
So they certainly want to maintain access. That's a priority for them.
Okay.
I think it's used primarily by residents and employees. I think the majority mm-hmm. of the guests use the in beach on either side.
Mm-hmm.
But it's one of those access points that's always been there. There's no other access to the shoreline kind of within that area unless you go all the way north to the inn. And with the seawall, you can't get in that cove. So there's a couple real nice beaches. There's normally a couple kayaks down there.
Mm-hmm.
And so the residents...
But that's on the north side.
When I was down the last time, there were some in here.
Oh, there were?
Yeah, oh. So people do use that. Again, I don't know the volume of use on that, but it's always kind of been a historic use. They've always had access, and that's a key feature to the farm. And so there was a lot of thought that kind of went into how to get down there, but at the same point, minimize the visual and kind of keep it natural. And so as you look at the shoreline, you're going to have, you know, this will be the native quarry stone, then you're going to have the masonry, but then this will match the inn nicely, and then a couple properties to the north of the farm also have the stabilization. So we feel it kind of blends into the farm.
Mm-hmm.
Chris, are you proposing to do any plantings to replace any of these compromised trees?
Or? So that's a good question. We actually, a couple things. One, the embankment's kind of been designed under the new state guidelines and the shoreline rules in the sense that it's going to be vegetated. So where we don't have the shot rock or we don't have the larger quarry stone and we put the riprap behind the wall, we're actually going to try to vegetate that. And that's been designed as kind of a conservation mix to kind of establish vegetation and help hold it together, and then you kind of let natural vegetation take its course. We are removing trees, which you can see in the plans with the X's. A lot of those are pretty severely compromised. I can tell you the farm has tried to minimize. They want to save every tree they possibly can. We actually met with Act 250 out there a couple weeks ago, and there was a couple trees that Act 250 thought maybe we should cut because they're leaning,
mm-hmm.
and the farm went out and reevaluated and said, actually, no, we'd like to keep those. We'll try keeping them. Mm-hmm. So we're really trying to keep what we can. The hard part is that without pushing the wall further to the west and creating a level spot, it's kind of hard to get the plantings in there
mm-hmm.
Without infringing on the road, which the road probably already has too many trees too close to it
mm-hmm.
for what the fire department would prefer. So it's kind of a compromise.
Yeah.
I think we're open to putting some plantings back if there's room. I don't think the farm's opposed to that. They'd want to put something natural in there. The one thing that I have actually just found out of late, which nobody seems to know at the state level, is that because the farm's under Act 250 jurisdiction, they actually does not trigger the shoreline permit for this project. Act 250 actually supersedes that because they have their own shoreline regulations, which actually just some of the coordinators and you know, technical points, nobody knew that. So I do have that information I just found today. So that would be the one other item. So we have to go through the whole Act 250 process for this project. So archaeology, historic preservation, aesthetics, tree cutting, replanting, primag soils. And so we're going to go through the town first to get your comments and then start the Act 250 process.
Chris,
yep.
If you, when you're building the stairs down, if you're doing the rock stairs, what's the width of the stairs going to be? It's like right now they're real men.
Yeah, so again, it's with quarry stone. We're showing it roughly 5 feet.
Okay.
But again, it's kind of natural quarry stone, so it really depends what the, you know, what the actual size is. It'll vary. I'd say if we're showing it 5 feet, it'll be somewhere between, you know, 4 to 5, 5
yeah,
and a half feet.
Just making sure it's not like two.
No. It's just for walking. It's not like it's a boat ramp or
yeah.
any vehicles or anything like that. It's just for walking.
So is it stairs or is it a ramp?
It's a ramp.
Okay, that's
yeah.
not the same.
Oh, yeah.
With stairs at the bottom, but the large part
yeah, you'll,
of it
you'll
is
have,
a
what
ramp.
It'll be is you'll have basically quarry stone, so it'll look like two kind of retaining walls. One
yeah.
will be a fill, one will be a cut, yeah. and you'll have a ramp going down.
Unlike the sort of almost, you know, the
yeah.
stairs going down
yeah.
like mm-hmm. vertically.
Yep. Yeah, well, I think what maybe is confusing on this is that what you're actually seeing is the contour lines.
Okay.
So it actually looks like stairs, and probably on your plan, you
yeah.
can't see the elevations in there.
So assuming like it's a really windy day, and because you have the lake right there,
yeah.
Are there any concerns about, because it's a ramp, it could potentially get very slippery?
You know, it's a great question. We actually have seen both. So we see a ramp with kind of an aggregate on there, and then we also see the stairs themselves, which become iced. And I honestly think that in the wintertime, if the conditions are such where you get the wave action, and the water's hitting there and it's freezing, it's going to be unsafe no matter what we do. The wave action is actually so severe down here that the road going in front of the coach barn, the farm has to shut down because the ice gets so thick it blows into the, you know, the trees on the other side. So I don't picture, under those conditions, I don't know what the farm protocol will be, but I'm sure they will not want people going down
Close
there
it.
If it's unsafe.
Yeah.
Would be my guess.
So the ramp surface is planted or stone?
Nope, it'll be stone.
Okay.
Yeah. Typically, again, those actually kind of self-vegetate themselves too,
yeah.
because it's not like it gets a lot of use, and you kind of get a herd path in the center, and you get vegetation on either side,
mm-hmm.
which helps stabilize it also.
Yeah.
I have kind of a question, or maybe it's a request. It's been pointed out to us that there's some question as to whether or not this erosion control plan is consistent with Shelburne Farms master plan.
I can speak to that.
Yeah, that'd be great. We do have an email from Mr. Webb explaining his point of view, which was well articulated in my view, persuasive.
Yeah, I can give you a quick overview. So yeah, I kind of skipped that. So we submitted the application. Again, this was already approved in 2008. And staff actually said, you know, as part of the original master plan, which I think was generated in 1985, when the farm became a PUD, they basically looked at all future development and tried to outline what the goals and intentions were of the farm. And staff said, you know, staff's feeling was that a shoreline structure wasn't specifically called out for in the original plan. At the time that occurred, the farm's intention was probably not erosion necessarily, but worrying about the historic structures, the breeding barn, at that mm-hmm. time it was a farm barn, it was a coach barn, it was all the structures. But the wording in there was that because it is a national, you know, historic landmark, there are historic roads, that the main goal of that is to rehabilitate and maintain existing structures. So under that, the farm actually feels, and the letter was actually written from Alec Webb, who's the president.
Oh, Alec, that's right.
Marshall is here tonight to speak also, but Alec couldn't make it tonight. Marshall and Alec are brothers. Essentially, the farm's feeling is that if they did nothing out here and they lost this is actually a carriage road, a historic carriage road. If they did nothing and lost a road, they feel that they'd be going against their master plan. So they actually feel that by stabilizing it, they're actually in support of their planning. I think it is something that in the future they can certainly add to the language. But the farm's goal isn't to go around and, you know, build shoreline structures and erosion control structures. Their intention is to maintain infrastructure and roadways. And to facilitate that, this is what they have to do. And I think Alex's letter kind of portrays that same.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm good.
I'm satisfied with that. Any other questions of Mr. Gallipo? Is there anybody in the audience who has questions of Mr. Gallipo or the applicant? Hearing nothing, I think we can move on to the motion phase of things. And as we do with the others, I'll move to finalize the record for this application, CU 16-05. May I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, motion carries. Next, I'd move to close with an indication of approval. And ask staff to prepare a decision to indicate approval of the conditional use application with conditions 1 through 4 as proposed. May I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? None. Motion carries. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you. Have a nice night.
The next matter on our agenda is application SUB-1601. It's an application by Elizabeth Smardon for final plan approval for a two-lot residential subdivision. The property is located at 1056 Falls Road in the Shelburne Falls Mixed Use District and the Village Design Review Overlay District. Is there anyone present this evening to testify on behalf of this application?
I am.
If you would step forward, take the mic, tell us your name, raise your right hand.
My name is Jack Milbank.
And do you swear or affirm to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth, Mr. Milbank?
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit more about this application? We've seen it before. I think it was at Sketch.
We've come to help support the Smardons and helping them get through the subdivision process. I forgot to introduce. I'm from Civil Engineering Associates as well. Mm-hmm. Basically, this project is on Falls Road in the Village Zoning District, and it's also in the portion of it's in the floodplain overlay district. It borders the La Platte River. It's a long, skinny lot, and the idea is to separate the lot into two parcels. The Falls Road parcel has an existing home on it. And the parcel created to the south is proposed to have a new structure to be served by a right-of-way because the lot as the frontage requirements are it's a pre-existing kind of doesn't have quite enough frontage, but it is going to be served by a 20-foot wide right-of-way, which is acceptable. Approved at the sketch plan. Properties will be served by town water, town sewer. So we're ready to entertain any questions you might have.
One question I have is the proposed easement, the 20-foot wide little road there, is that going to be paved?
That's a question for the applicants. We don't know much right now. We don't know much about what the idea is from the owner. The properties will be for sale, and that may be a question for the new owners at this point in time. At this point in time on this plan, the answer is no.
Okay. Any other questions of the applicant, Mr. Milbank?
This is in the historic district, isn't it?
Yeah, one of the things they haven't gotten design review approval, which is required before a final plan application can actually be approved. They're on an agenda for Thursday. Also, the applicant didn't solicit comments from the fire department, natural resources, school of police. My concern is the fire department more than anybody else. I had reached out. I didn't get anything back from them, but I don't think that should discount them from from actually being able to comment, especially...
How long ago did you get, reach out to him, Kate?
That was about a week ago. I hold public works meetings, and everyone is invited to attend. They didn't attend, but in our subdivision regulations, it's the burden of the applicant to actually get those comments beforehand. So it would be my suggestion to continue this until they have design review approval and comments from the fire department.
If there are no further questions of the applicant in that case, I would take up Kate's suggestion and move to continue the hearing for final plan application for SUB 16-01 to
September 21st.
September 21st, and at that time we would hope to get feedback from the Planning Commission and the Design Review and the Fire Department.
Municipal departments.
And any other municipal departments that haven't commented yet that should.
Okay.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
If I may comment.
Sure, if there's somebody else who would like to comment, yes? I need you to state your name.
Christina Pinger, and I'm representing the Smardons. And I understand why we're moving to the 21st. I would just ask if there are any other concerns other than those, the fire department comments and the design review, which, as we indicated, we're on the agenda for tomorrow morning.
Mm-hmm. Any other comments so they might be able to address them on the 21st? No?
Thank you.
Okay, that takes us to the next item. Thank you for coming this evening. We'll see you, well, most of us will see you on the 21st. So that takes us to the second to last item on our agenda, which is...
Yeah, we did.
We did. Did we move? No. Did I get a second?
You got a second from Judy.
There was no vote.
Oh, I'm so sorry. All in favor of the continuance to the 21st, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? No.
Thank you, John.
The next item on our agenda is Appeal A15-10, which is continued from our last meeting. It's the appeal by Champlain Housing Trust of the Notice of Violation. I'm not going to cite all of the various noticed violations. I think we all know what they are at this point. Let me start by saying that we held the meeting open to take any additional testimony and, more appropriately, discussion about the notice of violation. I guess I owe an apology both to the town and to the appellee, I suppose, would be called, insofar as I made it clear at the last hearing that I wanted memos ahead of the Labor Day weekend, but of course, I'll confess, I haven't read them all. I started reading them, and so I personally need more time to digest all of the information. So for that reason, I already can tell you I'm going to move, and I hope to get a second and a majority to continue the hearing yet again so that we have more time to digest the information that's been given to us, and then also ask both the appellant and the appellee any questions that we might have, given the importance of this issue and the amount of time that everybody's put into it. I think it merits our very thorough consideration, and it's not always the case that we get 33-page briefs and that kind of thing, and it's a lot for, I think, all of us to digest. I hope I'm speaking for the rest of my colleagues on the board. Not Alex. He's already written a decision, I think, probably. So that said, what I'd like to do this evening is ask both the appellant and the appellee if there's any other additional evidence that you would like to give. Does not look like there is. And then also to give you both an opportunity for a little bit of oral argument, which might be helpful for us to hear in terms of your highlighting important points, and if you're willing. And so I think I would go first to, did we, it's the town's burden. So I would ask the town if, through Ms. Safar, if you would like to make any oral argument. I understand that you...
Right now.
Yeah, right now.
And are we going to discuss whether you're not going to take the reply?
Okay, sure, I can do that. The first thing I want to say, though, can I stay where I am, or should I stay up here?
Why don't you come on up here, just so that...
Come on up. In response to the chair's request, whether we want to submit any additional evidence, I think I would just bring back the issue that I had asked Mr. Monty about discriminatory statements that were made by members of the town staff. And I think we've noted this in our reply memorandum that the issue of alleged discrimination has been raised by CHT, and it has been extensively briefed in their briefs. And there are allegations that the town has discriminated against CHT based upon those individuals which it serves. And so this issue has, although they had stated at the hearing, this is not what this proceeding is about. And I think we were then, the objection made by counsel was sustained and we weren't able to ask Mr. Monty those questions. They're now being, that very issue is now being briefed. And I guess if we were to ask for any additional information, I think before the close of the hearing, we would really like the opportunity to cross on those issues, because I think if that's gonna be raised, we need to be able to establish or question Mr. Monty on things that we got to question him on during his deposition, which namely is whether anybody from the town ever made any statements that were discriminatory towards, specifically discriminatory towards CHT. And so now I think it's relevant.
Okay, can you hold the phone on that just for a minute?
Absolutely.
Is that why you wanted to do a reply brief?
Not entirely. There were, I think, some things that were mischaracterized in terms of the town's arguments, and so there were other things that we wanted to address, but that...
Was that handed in today?
We did hand in a reply memo today.
We
did address this issue,
And you have it?
I have copies. I just wanted to make sure you guys were willing to accept them. So
a motion has been made by the... appellant to do a reply brief. Reply briefs in my world are common, and it gives the movant or the person with the burden the opportunity, so to speak, for the last word to rebut anything raised by the party who doesn't have the burden. I believe this is an important matter. We've taken a lot of evidence. It's an unusual matter, at least in my short tenure. It's the only appeal I've seen. It's the only case that we've had that's gone for such a long period of time in terms of the amount of time devoted. So I would be in favor of accepting a reply brief. I would like Harbor Place to have the opportunity, or Champlain Housing Trust to have the opportunity to argue why a reply brief should not be accepted, if that's the position, Karen, that you want to take.
Thank you. They've submitted one for two.
When Claudine and I had originally discussed the schedule for briefing, we had actually contemplated that there would be both direct briefs and reply briefs from both sides. At the last meeting, it seemed the board was concerned with expediting the process and, not necessarily willing to extend the briefing schedule, so we hadn't addressed reply briefs. But I don't object to the submission of a reply brief. I prepared one and submitted it as well. I would ask that if the board accepts a reply brief from the town, it would accept a reply brief from CHT also.
Okay. So that being the case, I'll make a motion to accept a reply brief from the town and a surreply brief from Champlain Housing Trust. May I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? None? Okay, we'll take them. Okay. that takes care of that matter. We're all good. So I'm going to allow you to hand the microphone back to Ms. Safar. Are you prepared to, you want us to address this issue of discrimination before we move forward with any sort of argument?
Well, I think that it's, I want to raise it again, and if it's, if we are going to continue this hearing and there is the opportunity for additional evidence, this, you know, I think it's incumbent upon me to raise this again and say we want to cross on this issue if we have that opportunity, because I think if I don't, then I'm
understood
not doing what I need to be doing.
So at the time, I sustained the objection on the thought that whether or not discrimination is happening is not germane to the issue that's before the review board. Because what's before us is whether or not, what's before us is whether Harbor Place is operating as a hotel or a motel. And I don't really see how the question of discrimination is germane to our job. So I sustained it. Otherwise, I could see this getting into, you know, like a 1983 action or something like that, which I'm trying to avoid. I have not seen Ms. Tyler's, I have not read Ms. Tyler's brief, so I suppose we should get this issue resolved before going further, because I don't want to take any oral argument if I or someone on the board moves to accept additional evidence. So I guess I would ask you to pass the baton back to Ms. Tyler. Are you, is CHT making the argument that the reason why this appeal, notice of this violation was issued is for discriminatory purposes?
So I'm glad to explain my view of that issue. There is a provision of the Fair Housing Act that prohibits municipalities from making land use decisions on a basis that discriminates against individuals based on disability, income, or receipt of public benefits. There's a private right of action under that statute, so theoretically, CHT could at some point in the future, they have a choice, they could bring a complaint to the Human Rights Commission, or they could bring an action in Superior Court. So my view of that situation has been, if they should choose to do that at some point in the future, that would be a new action in a different forum with opportunity for full discovery with the creation of a new record. So my view of this is that CHT is not attempting to or required to create a record in this proceeding before the Development Review Board that would establish that theoretical future potential claim for discrimination under the Fair Housing Act. There are also provisions of Title 24 that prohibit municipalities from, I wasn't really prepared to address this issue, I don't have the language in front of me, but prohibit you, the Development Review Board, I believe, from construing the zoning bylaws in a way that would discriminate in violation of the provision of the Fair Housing Act that I just discussed. So would prohibit the Development Review Board from construing the bylaws in a way that would discriminate against people based on disability, income level, or the receipt of public benefits. If CHT were to believe that that had occurred after your decision is issued, it could theoretically complain to the Attorney General, which could investigate the situation, and could theoretically bring an action in environmental court to enjoin, you know, the decision that was considered discriminatory. But again, my view of this, I mean, I have addressed it in my briefing because I think it's important for the board to be aware of these requirements of the law and the possibility that it isn't permitted to construe the bylaws in the way that discriminates based on disability, income, or the receipt of public benefits. But again, my view of this has been that if CHT should choose to make a claim of that nature, it would be in the future, in a different forum, a new proceeding, a new record, opportunity for full discovery on both part of both sides, And so I guess I want to be clear that CHT certainly isn't intending to waive its ability to make, it hasn't made any decision to my knowledge as to whether, you know, it would choose to make that type of claim, but it's certainly not waiving its ability to do so in any way.
But you're not asserting it in this particular action.
No, I don't believe that the Development Review Board is charged with determining whether discrimination under the Fair Housing Act has occurred.
Do you believe, I just glanced at your memo, do you believe that the Development Review Board, that there's a provision in Title 24 that would prohibit the Development Review Board from enforcing the applicable section of our zoning bylaws if it has a discriminatory impact? Is that an argument?
Yes. I think, and again, I don't have the language in front of me at the moment, but I believe Title 24 says that the Development Review Board is not allowed to construe the zoning bylaws in a way that violates the Fair Housing Act. And specifically the provision of the Fair Housing Act that prohibits the making of land use decisions in a way that discriminates based on disability, income, or the receipt of public benefits. So and that's the reason that I've addressed those issues in our brief to some degree, because I think when the Development Review Board is considering the issues, that's obviously an important limitation on the way in which the zoning bylaws can be interpreted.
Does anybody have any questions of Ms. Tyler or Ms. Safar on this particular topic? And the topic is, just to be clear, and I'm stating it, and I'll allow either one of you to correct me, mm-hmm. The topic is whether or not we should take additional testimony about whether there was any discriminatory conduct on the part of the town in issuing the notice of violation, because there's at least the possibility that our, what the heck?
Just press the home button.
Sorry, for some reason, Siri's giving me a hard time. There's concern on Ms. Tyler's part that we might find ourselves, correct me if I'm wrong, in a position where we're issuing a decision that would be violative of some provision of Title 24 insofar as the result would be discriminatory?
That's basically correct. I mean, what I've argued in particular in the reply brief, you know, in my view, the town's entire argument regarding why Harbor Place is not open to the general public, if the board were to accept that argument and were to affirm the notice of violation on that basis, I think it would be construing the bylaws in the way that discriminates in violation of the Fair Housing Act, because essentially what the town has argued is that people who receive social services, who receive general assistance benefits from the Vermont Department of Children and Families because they're poor, or people who receive social services from Howard Center or the other organizations that make referrals to Harbor Place because they're poor or because in some instances they have a disability, the town's argument is that those people are, you know, a special class of people. I can't remember the exact language used in the town's brief, but those people are somehow a special class of people who are apart from the general public. And because Harbor Place serves those people, doesn't serve the general public. And I think that if the Development Review Board were to affirm the notice of violation on that particular basis, it would basically be construing the bylaws in a way that is discriminatory, that discriminates against people on the basis of disability, on the basis of low income, on the basis of the receipt of public benefits, because you would be finding that those people, again, are some type of, you know, special class of people who aren't part of the general public. And a quote, and a lodging establishment that serves those people isn't open to the general public because those people are not part of the general public. So I think fundamentally for the Development Review Board, in construing the ordinance and what it means, the bylaws and what it means, in our view, if the bylaws were construed in that way, that would be violative of the Fair Housing Act.
Does anybody else have any questions? Ms. Safar?
I'm dying to respond. Yeah, I wholeheartedly disagree. That is not at all what the town has said. There, what we have not said is that these people are poor and therefore they are a class. What we have said is that they come by virtue of referrals. Therefore, they are a particular group or a subset of people that belongs to a specific group. It has nothing to do with whether they are of a certain income level or are serviced by DCF. It's the fact that they belong to an exclusive category or group of people that does not include everybody, irrespective of income. And this could be the same exact principle if these people were of incredibly high income or of a particular religious organization or of a particular, any type of category, you name it. If it was solely by virtue of these referral contracts, that's the point. And it's the use of the property that results based upon this arrangement, not the fact that there is an arrangement and who the people are that benefit from the arrangement. That's absolutely irrelevant and not at all the argument. So I think it's sort of being twisted in a way to say you're intentionally discriminating against this group of people because they're poor. That's not at all the argument. So I want to be clear that I think it is important for the town to be able to establish that not on one single occasion did any member of the staff ever say anything that was intentionally discriminatory or intend to show that there was any discriminatory intent on the part of the town. I think that's important. And particularly if they're saying, well, if you side with the zoning administrator, you're going to be discriminating. I don't think that's true.
Ms. Safar, if these referrals were made and the group of people that were being referred, the only thing that they had in common, they literally had nothing else in common except for the fact that they were being referred by one agency. Somehow, every single person was different and had nothing in common. Would you still object on the same grounds?
Well, I can't really answer that, Alex, and I'm not trying to be evasive, but it depends on what the agency's purpose of referral was. Like, if it was an agency like hotels.com, I think that this question was asked of Dean. I think that's a kind of different scenario. That's a vehicle for people to make reservations. That's open to the public. You don't have to be a member of a specific category. You don't have to qualify in any kind of way. They're not a grouped category of people. And this is a different thing. This is like you can qualify for X and by get a referral by meeting these specific criteria. And if you don't meet the criteria, then you don't get in to be able to get the referral. I think that, my example was, look, the, XYZ social club is open to members of the public, but if I'm not, and I can go in and I can pay my fee and I can be a member of the social club, but if I haven't done all those things and I knock on the door, I can't go in. So it's there's a difference between being a member of the general public that shows up at a park where anybody and everybody can walk in. You don't have to pay. You don't have to be a member of anything specific. That's really different from you can only come in if you're a member. And here, essentially, what we have is you can only come in to Harbor Place if you come through one of these doors, and you can get in this door based on being whatever it is that necessitates getting through that door. So it's a category of people. And
I just want to, before we get too far of into oral argument, I want to resolve this particular issue, which is I'm going to treat it as a request to reconsider my sustaining Ms. Tyler's objection to questions by Ms. Safar about discrimination of Michael Monti. Does anyone feel, based on the arguments that you've heard so far, whether we should open the hearing for evidence on that matter, or if, does anyone feel they need to hear more from either Ms. Tyler or Ms. Safar before making that determination?
I think we've heard a lot about them saying why they are or are not discriminatory, but not whether or not we should be talking about, whether or not we should hear Mr. Monti's evidence on whether or not. So, like, I'm hearing their arguments, like, Ms. Tyler saying what the town's doing could be construed as discriminatory, Ms. Safar's statements that they're not, but I'm not too sure their arguments for whether or not we should hear Mr. Monti's testimony on that.
So, when Ms. Safar was questioning Mr. Monti about whether or not they felt, or Harbor Place felt, it was being discriminated against throughout this process by virtue of the population they serve, Ms. Tyler objected. I sustained it. I didn't allow Ms. Safar to ask more questions about that. Now Ms. Safar is saying, hey, look at the brief. They're arguing that this is a matter of discrimination, and you didn't let me ask questions about that. So I think it's a fair argument. I think Ms. Tyler is saying that we might be in the position of violating the Fair Housing Act if we affirm the appeal or grant the appeal or the notice of violation, if we uphold the notice of violation, because it might be having a discriminatory impact on a protected class of individuals. So the question, I think, is since that seems to be an issue, I don't particularly see it as a germane issue, but it's an issue that's out there that the town didn't have the opportunity to fully flesh out by evidence. So should we reconsider that ruling, allow Mr. Monti to come back at the hearing that we're going to have on October 18th on that issue? And my particular vote would be yes for that limited purpose, as long as it's for that very limited purpose, given the importance of this appeal, given our desire to get it right, given that we, you know, need to be mindful of the amount of resources that have already been put into this. It would be good to get it right. Does that answer your question?
Sort of, sure.
So I've been away from this for a while, traveling and not thinking about this. And
I guess the concern that I have is coming back, and this is coming up now. This seems to be a fairly major concern, all things considered. It worries me that this far into it, that it's coming up now, and I just don't understand why it wouldn't have been something that came up as a fairly significant issue sooner.
Yeah, honestly, I don't really myself understand the answer to that, except I could say that I haven't really digested it myself. I don't know exactly how it plays out, but I want to err on the side of being over inclusive with evidence rather than keeping evidence out, because. Mm-hmm. If we let all the evidence in, then and we have the opportunity to consider it, in my view, it minimizes the risk of mistake. Right. Well,
20 minutes ago, I would have said, you go one way or the other. You either have Mr. Monti back, or you don't allow it to be brought up, you know, in this, but the genie's already out of the bottle, so to speak. So, and I think it makes sense for all the reasons you stated.
Okay. Thank you.
I don't feel like it has a lot to do with our core decision, but I can see your point in just getting it all out there. We've considered everything, but
I don't think it would hurt us to take the evidence. It's up to us as to whether or not we want to consider it.
Right. How much weight to give it, correct?
Right. And I'm just hoping that it doesn't turn into a
a whole new hours of
three nights.
Okay, so then let me make a formal motion to reconsider the ruling on sustaining Ms. Tyler's objection to Ms. Safar's questioning of Mr. Monty. And I want to overrule it. Let me state it a little more clearly so the record is understandable. I'd like to move to reverse sustaining Ms. Tyler's motion to keep out testimony from Mr. Monty about discrimination. And along with that, we've held the hearing open, continue the hearing until our next available meeting, which I understand is the 18th of October, for the purpose in terms of additional evidence of taking only evidence from Mr. Monty on that issue. Can I have a second to the motion?
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? None. Motion carries. So that being the case, is that
great.
Helpful to you, Ms. Safar?
Yes, thank you.
That being the case, I'm wondering if it would make sense to just continue the hearing at this time rather than take additional argument from any of the attorneys. So I think that's, I'll make that motion to continue the hearing on everything else at this time and take oral argument on the 18th. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? None. Motion carries. Thank you. And that would take us to the last item on our agenda. Any other business?
Just a correction to that continuing state. It's the 19th, not the 18th.
You're okay. It's the 19th.
So it's October
19th? Yes.
October 19th.
Is that a problem for either of you?
I don't think so, no.
You have no other hearings in the evening on October 19th?
No, definitely not.
I did.
Judy did. Let's make sure that I'm good on that day. Thank you. Thanks, everybody, for coming.
Should we do potluck?
That's not a bad idea, except for that we'd have to notice it and invite everybody.
You can tell what I'm worried about.
We have some findings of fact, I think, to sign. Other than that, is there any other business that anybody has? Okay, let me just check the calendar here.
Can
October.
Do the calendar or something?
Will you be able to make it, Alex, on the 19th?
I don't know if I have to debate that or not, but I hope not. Usually don't.
I'm sorry, yeah. Move to adjourn the meeting? Second?
Second.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries.